G'day and welcome back to Buildsum, and as you can see we're out on the job site and all the wall frames are up and we're ready to start putting up our ceiling for our pitched roof. So just a couple of points, at this stage you would have all your permanent bracing in place and you should still have a heap of temporary bracing in, and I wouldn't remove any temporary bracing until I had my roof on. Just helps to keep the walls nice and straight while you're pitching the roof and putting in the ceiling frame. And also at the moment you won't have any of your nominal bracing, which is coming from your internal linings, helping to brace the house. So you want to leave as much temporary bracing in place as you can until you get the roof on. So once you're ready to go, the first thing I would do is I would actually mark out the position of my roof members. Okay, we design the roof first, and we're going to make the roof, or we're going to make the ceiling frame fit around the roof frame, because the roof frame's sort of dependent on a couple of key positions, whereas we can move the ceiling frame around a bit. Now the other thing you'll notice is that we've got a couple of big area out this end of the house, which is fairly open, and that's going to take or need some extra support. So in the design process of this house, we determined and we identified that we needed a couple of large beams in this area. So this one here is they're both strutting beams, but we're also going to incorporate them into the ceiling design. So this is going to become a strutting counter beam, and this will end up being a strutting hanging beam, and I'll show you the difference in those as we go. Now a couple of important things when we put large beams that are going to carry large loads into a house is, one, they have to be packed up off the top plate so that when they're loaded and if they bow, that bow is not going to make a depression in our ceiling, so they're normally packed up about 25 mm, and we make sure we have a load path, so we have a stud located directly underneath them so that you can transfer the load straight down rather than through the top plate and then down. So we end up with a large number of studs or a couple of studs underneath those point loads. Okay, this one's packed up high enough because it's going to be actually above the joists. Okay, so that's a couple of things that we can do first, and then we can drop in our ceiling frame. All our ceiling joists can go into position. Okay, and I'll show you a couple of situations. So in here over the entry we have a fairly small room, it's only an entryway, and these ceiling joists here are what we call, they're a single span, so they're spanning from this wall to this wall. Okay, and that the span tables in the timber framing code tell us that they can do that quite adequately, so that's all we really need to do with them. We can just drop them in there like that. For a larger room like over here, what we've done is we've actually taken this joist and we've run it over this wall and landed it on this wall, and we could actually run it all the way through if we had a long enough piece of timber, but in this case we've just gone to there. So this has turned this joist into a continuous span joist, so it's running continuous over one or more supports, the support being this wall here. Now what that means is that the distance it spans here can actually be slightly greater than what it could span if it actually stopped on this wall. So any continuous span member can span greater than it would if it was a single span. And that's because the sort of seesaw effect over this wall counteracts each other, and it spans more. It's been proven. So even though this is a little bit longer or a little bit wider than the entryway, the span tables tell us that a continuously spanned beam can still span that distance quite easily, so that's quite acceptable. Now eventually you're going to get to a situation where you're in a room here and the span is longer than you want a single span, or longer than you can have a single span beam. Obviously we can't just put a wall in the middle of this room, so we need to somehow put an extra support in here to make these joists carry and make them continuous. So what we do is we put in a hanging beam, or sometimes called a hanger. Okay, again you'll need to look at the timber framing code to work out the span or the size of the beam for the span of the room, but you know, you get that calculated and then you can install the hanging beam. You can see that this end here has been cut off to match the slope of the roof, and there's certain precautions we have to take when we do that to make sure that this end is going to take the weight. And because it's such a deep beam, we have to make sure that it doesn't want to turn over on us under load either. So on this end, you would bolt it to one of your rafters. And you can see on this end, we've actually strapped this end with some builder strap to stop it from rolling over. Or you could block it, you know, put solid timber blocking in there, which would have the same effect. Okay, so there's a hanging beam, or a hanger, supporting our ceiling joists over the room. Now, eventually, just another point, sorry, before I go on. If your hanging beam ends up landing on your plate, obviously it has to be packed up the width of the ceiling joist, so in this case 90mm. But if it lands in a section where it's not directly supported, so it's not over a stud, it's a good idea and it's a requirement that you beef up your top plate just by putting a noggin on edge underneath the top plate just to take some of that load. It's not a great deal of load, it's only a ceiling load, but that just helps to beef up the top plate wherever your hangout crosses a wall plate. Okay, so that's just another thing you need to do. Now, eventually your hangout is going to get to a point where it's going to be too long. It won't span that distance itself. So have a look here. We have a hanger running from this wall all the way through to that wall there, and it wouldn't do it by itself. Couldn't find a hanging beam big enough, so as I mentioned at the start of the video, we had to install this, which is a strutting beam, but it's also now, because it's taking the hanging beams, it's a counter beam. Runs the same direction as the ceiling joists, and it is packed up off the plate at 25mm to allow for any deflection, and it has a point load, or the studs under it, to take the point load. Also, the hanging beam is connected to the counter beam in accordance with the timber framing code. There are a couple of different methods. Most common and popular method nowadays is to use the proprietary joist hanging boots just to connect it in there. So the hanger is carrying the joists, the counter beam is carrying the hanging beams, or the hanger. Now, what we can also should use is to tie the ceiling joist to the hanging beam. You can't just skew nail it, you need to use a connection, and you can get these fasteners, sort of commonly called ceiling dogs, and you can see I've got one there, Mr. Joist, I've got one there. The reason we've done that is because on the other side we've put the other one, and that just means you're loading the hanging beam evenly and you're not going to make it want to turn over because you've got all your connecting plates on the one side of the beam. So you just stagger it down the beam and that'll help to stop it from rolling over. Plus we've got it tied off at this end anyway, so it shouldn't go anywhere. Now, this is a similar situation, except this is a hanging beam combined strutting beam. So it's a similar situation, except it's running at 90 degrees to the joists. It's packed up 90mm, and this one in particular, I've actually had to join my ceiling joists on this one, so we've just got them lapped past each other, running past. We've got dogs, ceiling dogs on this side, and if you spin around to the other side, the other joist has got ceiling dogs on this side, so they're all holding that up. And again, up in this space, I've got another ceiling beam doing the same job up here. Okay, so that's pretty much all the members of my roof. It's just a quick diagram showing the purlins, which would be holding the rafters, and the struts coming down onto the combined hanging beam, strutting beam, and the combined counter beam, strutting beam. So there you go, this is a quick look at a ceiling frame and all the different types of members that you might find in a typical ceiling frame.